Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for coming. This afternoon's meeting will be presented by Celine Dekrenlidiao. She's from the company called Insured Rekatop. So they're involved with laboratory analysis of chemical and chemical compounds, especially persistent organic pollutants, both from the environmental analysis, from soil samples and so forth, and also they're also into biomonitoring as well. So quite a big important. And Celine is here for a particular project, working on a pesticide project, looking at in-depth exposure assessment, looking at environmental sampling and biomonitoring. So please to have
you. Thanks a lot again for the introduction. So firstly, I would just like to present myself like in few words. So I would just like to say I done some bachelor in physics from the University of Science and Technology in Lille. Like you can hear from my accent that I'm definitely not Czech and I'm French. Then it's like I complete as well like some master in physics specialized in atmospheric sciences. Afterwards, I moved to Czech Republic at the Recetox, where I done my PhD in environmental chemistry. I done some first postdoc at the Max Planck Institute for Chemistry in Germany. And now it's about 2 years ago, I came back like in Czech Republic doing my second postdoc. So firstly, like let's present where is Czech Republic. It's called like as East, or it's seen as Eastern country, but basically it's really in Central Europe. And Masaryk University is located in Brno, which is the second largest city in Czech Republic. Few numbers about Masaryk University, it's about more than 30,000 students, 5,000 employees, 600 different study programs, about 1,000 scientific articles published like every year, 1,000 research grants. We have even some research station in Antarctica, and we are educating students for more than 100 years. Recetox is a research center for toxic compounds in the environment. It's about like 200 research staff, including 70 PhD students. It has 47 ongoing projects, like at the national, European, and international scales. Then Recetox is a national center for toxic compounds in the Czech Republic, but it's also the regional center for Stockholm Convention. In total, we have about 4,000 meters square of research facilities. We have like fully equipped like new laboratories like with different liquid chromatography, gas chromatography, mass spectrometry. And Recetox is divided into four different research divisions, including like environmental chemistry, toxicology, protein engineering, and organic photochemistry. I don't know why you do that. So now, but Recetox, just I will just say a few more words about really environmental chemistry section. So it's like for the last years, we were mainly like some environmental centers, so focusing mainly on the soil, air, water pollution. So for this, we have established some trace analytical laboratory, which is accredited for like many organic pollutants. But for the last year, we are more and more moving towards the analysis of the impacts of environment on human health. So for this, we have two different cohort studies, one old and one more recent, which is focusing on pregnant mother and following like their child with their health for the 20 years. And right now we are analyzing more and more human samples, so blood, urine, cordon blood, milk from mothers. And we have three different research infrastructures, which are open access. The first one is Genesis database, where you can find like really many different information or like concentrations of different pollutants from the environment, including South Africa. Then we have also what MUFARO will come here like in Czech Republic next year to work on the trace. It's like open access to the trace analytical laboratory, which means based on the selection, on some specific selection, anyone can come bringing their own samples and have access to the laboratory and analyze them within Recetox. And as I said earlier, we also have like different cohort studies, ELSPAC and CELSPAC. And if you want more information, I really recommend you to have a look at the website, which unfortunately is not absolutely updated, but definitely contains some interesting information. Now in this presentation, I will just describe briefly like what are semi-volatile organic compounds, the main processes in the atmosphere. I will just explain how we are like measuring concentrations from the air, what happens in the laboratory afterwards, and then just few results. I will try to focus as much as possible on pesticides, but we'll also include like different pollutants. So firstly, like a semi-volatile organic compound, it's organic compounds with a boiling point range between like 240 to 400 degrees Celsius. I will try to focus mainly on pesticides, but I will also like say a few words about flame retardants and combustion related or like industrial compounds. So firstly, about pesticides, from my point of view, I see like two different groups of pesticides. In one hand, there is the organochlorine pesticides, including DDT or hexachlorocyclohexane, which was sold as lindane. And at least in Europe, they have been banned since late 70s in most countries. And OCPs are really dangerous because they are really persistent and extremely toxic for human health. On the other hand, I'm also interested about the currently used pesticide, but the term current is a bit awkward because indeed it represents pesticides which are currently used, but it also represents pesticides which have been banned. For example, in Europe, atrazine has been banned. But basically, it represents like the group of pesticides which were used after OCPs, once OCPs were banned. And these new pesticides are really widely used in agriculture or in forestry. But unfortunately, I would say we still have not enough information about their environmental fate or their toxic effects. Another group of compounds I will speak about is the flame retardants, which basically are additives which are used in electronics, so in computers, mobile phones, kitchen appliances, but also in textiles, building materials, plastics or paints. So basically you can imagine that in this room, for example, it's full of flame retardants and usually the indoor concentrations are much higher than the outdoor concentrations. And in this group, there are like two different subclasses. So the polybrominated diphenylethers and the novel flame retardants. Similar as OCPs, because polybrominated diphenylethers are really persistent and toxic, their usage has been banned over the last decade, and therefore the use of novel flame retardants has significantly increased over the last decade. And finally, the last group of compounds, which I would say from toxical point of view are really the most toxic, is the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, the polychlorinated dibenzodioxins and furans, and the polychlorinated biphenyls. Now we'll just say PHEs, PBDs, dioxinitriles, PCBs, because it's really long name and it's complicated to say. But I would say for PHEs, they have some natural sources. So they may come from forest fires, volcanic eruptions. They may be produced during the biosynthesis of phytoplankton or bacteria. But I would say for most of these compounds, particularly in urban areas, it's really they're influenced by humans. And so it's like they have some sources from fossil fuel combustion, domestic heating, waste incinerators, traffic, oil refining, steel and iron manufacturing, coke and asphalt production, and PCBs are also used as dielectric sheets in electrical equipment. So in this presentation, you will hear quite often the word like persistent organic pollutants. So what a compound needs to be classified as persistent organic pollutants? It needs to fulfill like four different conditions. Firstly, it needs to be persistent. This means like either its half-life in the water is higher than 2 months, or the half-life in soil or sediment is higher than 6 months. Then it also needs to be bioaccumulative. Basically, it means that the concentration from the medium, let's say from the water, will increase for the food chain. And this is characterized by some octanol water partitioning coefficient or the log of this coefficient higher than 5, or like the bioconcentration factor higher than 5,000. Then it also needs to be prone to long-range atmospheric transports. So either if its half-life in the air is higher than 2 days, or if it's detected in remote regions, for example, in Arctic, where it was never used before. And finally, it also needs to be toxic. So we need to have proof of adverse effects or indication that it creates some potential damage to human health or the environment. And all of the POPs are like compounds which are classified as POPs. They are regulated within the Stockholm Convention, which was signed by 179 countries, including like South Africa. And therefore, their usage are really restricted or banned. It depends for which compounds. And among the compounds I described earlier, OCP, so the old pesticide, dioxin and furans, PCBs, PBDs, they have been classified as persistent organic pollutants. But it's not the case of PAHs because they are not persistent enough. Neither of COPs, and I would say COPs, it's really, they have many different properties. So it's, I don't see them as really being included as POPs as a group, but should be really individual substances. Neither as a case of novel flame retardants. And now it's like, what happens once these compounds reach the air? Firstly, like they can reach the air from different sources, so either from cars, from industries, from pesticides or like agricultural activities, then from volcanic eruptions, forest fires, or like dust storms. And once they will be emitted into the air, they will partition between the gaseous and the particulate phase. And depending on this partitioning, they will go different physico-chemical processes. For example, they may be transformed into the air, either via photolysis, or they may also undergo like different chemical reactions with OH or ozone radicals. But then they may also be deposited to the Earth surface. So this may happen through dry deposition, which basically we cannot see, but right now lots of chemicals are getting like deposited onto the carpets. Or also like they may be scavenged by cloud droplets and reach either via snow or via rain the surface. But these compounds are really not immobile, which means that once they will reach the soil or the water, they will further go again like air surface exchange such as revolatilization. And each of these specific like processes is extremely important because it will affect their atmospheric residence time and therefore their potential for long-range atmospheric transport. It has been shown that basically many of these pollutants are mainly emitted in mid-latitude, and then they really undergo like a huge series of volatilization, then they are transported by the air, then they are depositing, then they are again revolatilizing, and then they are really reaching like high latitudes, which is so-called the grasshopping effects. Now it's like I will present quite a lot of results about air concentrations, but how do we derive like air concentrations of these toxic compounds? There are two different methods. The first one is based on active sampling. Basically, we have some big instrument which looks like this, and where it's like it's sucking, you have a huge pump, and it's sucking air at quite like a high flow rate, and then you use some filter to collect the particles, and some adsorbents to collect like the gaseous phase. I would say for me, I prefer much more like this sampling technique because it's really accurate. It's ideal if you want to understand specific processes. You can reach some high temporal resolutions, for example, like taking some samples every few hours. But the problem is that it's much more expensive. It's more difficult to use. It has a large size. You need some electricity, so you cannot sample like really everywhere. It needs like really high requests on personal involvement, on changing the samples, on like cleaning like all of the different parts. It's subject to some artifacts and it's a bit noisy, or like it can be a bit or really noisy. Some second techniques, which was also used here like last year, is based on passive sampling. So there are like two different types of passive samplers, either like so-called the puff pass, which are like two balls where inside you have some absorbents, or then also like XAD passive sampler. And it's like the only main difference is on the design and also on the resin or like adsorbent which is used. And I would say this is really great because it's really cheap, it's easy to use, it's small size, you don't need electricity, so you can place it like everywhere. You usually change these samples from 1 month up to 1 year, so you don't need like so much personal involvement. They are not noisy, so it's perfect if you want to use them in working environment or in private bedrooms, for example. But the main problem with them, I would say, is that they are only semi-quantitative, which means that the reported air concentrations are within a ratio of 2 or 3 to the real air concentrations determined by active sampling. Then they are also strongly influenced by meteorological parameters. They may be subject as well to sampling artifacts. And right now there is a big debate worldwide to know, like it's not, for example, the XAD sampler is collecting only the gas phase. But for the puff pass, this one, it's a bit unclear like how much of particles really reach these samples. Now it's like once we get all of the samples, what happens? Basically, firstly, it's like there are lots of work. It's just one slide, but it takes many months. And it's like firstly, we need to extract all of these samples in the laboratory. So in Recitox, we are using like automatic SOXLET extractor. Then it's like depending on the compounds targeted, we need to clean them or to purify the extract. So we use like a silicon columns. And finally, like we analyze them by means of gas chromatography or liquid chromatography coupled with mass spectrometry techniques. So firstly, I just want to really highlight the difference in persistency between old pesticides and new pesticides. So this was based on 120 samples collected over 2 years at a background site in the Czech Republic. And firstly, in terms of OCPs, this compound, they haven't been used for 40 years in Czech Republic. But still, we could find that the most, like all of them, they are detected in at least half of every single air samples. And the most persistent one, like gamma HTH, DDT, DDE, they are detected in every single sample. So this really showed that they are extremely persistent. Even 40 years after they have been banned, we can still find them in the air, in the water, in the soil, in almost every single compartment. On the other hand, I was also interested about 27 individual pesticides, which represent about 24% of the Czech market. And here I would say we observe like different behavior. In one hand, like the pesticides which were not authorized for use in Czech Republic, usually we could find them only like in few samples. But on the other hand, like the pesticides which were used like in largest quantities in Czech Republic, we could detect them in more than 50% of the samples. And particularly, I would say chlorpyrifos, isoproterone, metazaclor, and terbutilazine were found in about like 80% of all of the samples, which means as well in winter, where clearly like they are not used, or in Europe, they are mainly used like in spring periods. Then I just want to show like a few results about the seasonal variations. So in one hand, for the pesticides, we found mainly like one peak occurring, like related to the pesticide application technique. For most of them, was in April, May. But for some of them, which are used for like maize, it's like they are applied a bit later, so in August or September. But this is different. Let's say this was for the new pesticides. The old pesticide, as DDT, we could see that it shows higher concentrations in summer. And this is really in agreement with the knowledge because these compounds, mainly, they are stored in the soil. The soil is the main reservoir. And so they are really influenced or they are revolatilizing from the soil at higher temperatures. So usually, we observe like higher concentrations for them in summer compared to, while for new pesticides was in spring. Then one thing that was really interesting is that we found for chlorpyrifos, chlorotoluene, and isoproterone, we had like two peaks per year. And for me, I say I'm really amazed here by the knowledge that University of Cape Town has about the spraying records. And you really know exactly when a pesticide was used. It's not the case in Czech Republic. And we know that many, they are only used in April, May. So this second peak was really like a huge surprise for us. And my hypothesis is just that in October, November, usually the farmers are plowing the fields. And this maize, I think that all of the pesticides which are soaked to the soil particles, while during like plowing the field, they will revolatilize to the air. And this may be what we are observing here. But further studies will be needed to validate this hypothesis. But not all of the compounds like show higher concentration in spring. In case of the PHEs, dioxynitrites, dioxin-like PCBs, they usually like show higher concentration in winter or like autumn, and this is attributed to two different points. Firstly, in winter, especially in Czech Republic, it's extremely cold, so it's like you really need like lots of domestic heating, and this is the main source of these compounds. Secondly, in winter, we have much lower atmospheric boundary layer height. With that means we have like less room, let's say, in the air for dispersion of the pollutants. So this will increase the concentration we are observing here. Then I just want to say like a few words about the gas particle partitioning, because this is extremely important process, because For example, the photolysis is much more efficient for compounds in the gas phase, while deposition processes is much more efficient for compounds in the particulate phase. So it's like before to understand how like pesticides or other toxic chemicals will behave or like will stay in the environment, we really need to know firstly like what is their gas particle partitioning behavior. And here in case of PBDEs, so on the y-axis we have like the particulate fraction measures. So basically like a value of 0.2 means that 20% of the compound is in the particulate phase. And what we and the red dots are the temperature. And we can really see that we have huge seasonality. And basically, let's say for BDE99, while in summer we have about 10% of it which is present in the particulate phase, in winter we have about more than 90% of it which is present in the particulate phase. And this is true for PBDEs, but it's also true for PHEs, dioxin infrareds, dioxin-like PCBs. We can see that the particulate fraction measured in cold seasons is significantly higher than the particulate fraction found in summer. And here we can see that it goes from the less volatile compounds to the most, from the most volatile compounds to the least volatile compounds. And so their physicochemical properties is extremely important because more volatile compounds will be more present in the gas phase compared like to the higher. And here it's the same. In one hand, we just have furans. In the other hand, we have dioxins. But it's like from least volatile to more volatile compounds. So it's like the temperature is extremely important in the gas particle partitioning behavior, but also the individual physicochemical properties of the compounds. And then I also looked at the gas particle partitioning of like old and new pesticides. And I would say once more, as they have like many different physicochemical properties, we observe different behavior. In one hand, like compounds as carbendazim, isoproterol, and prochlorase, they are mainly found in the particulate phase. On the other hand, all of the organochlorine pesticides and chlorpyrifos, S-metallochlor, they are mainly found only in the gaseous phase. And finally, we found other pesticides as metazaclor or terbutilazine, which represent both in the gaseous and in the particulate phase. But once more, as for the other compounds, we could see like really extremely important seasonal variations in the gas particle partitioning. And based on that, let's say for atmospheric scientists as me, it's really important to try to model or to accurately model like this gas particle partitioning behavior. Basically, like we really want to know whether like a pesticide present in the gas phase will be absorbed into the particles, or whether it will be adsorbed, so it will stay on the surface, because it will really change a lot of this of their environmental fate. So for this, what I've done firstly is that I plot the Kp, which is the gas particle partitioning coefficient, against KOA, which is the octanol air partitioning coefficient. And here was really interesting because we know for OCPs, they are mainly only undergoing like absorption. But here we found clearly different behaviors between like old pesticides and new pesticides. Then I've decided like to, using like some really wonderful data from David Martin, like investigating the soil air exchange of pesticides, I just try to compare like the gas particle partitioning coefficient with the soil air partitioning coefficient. And basically here was really interesting because we found similar slopes, which clearly suggest that compounds between the gas and particles, they will behave exactly the same way than between the soil and the air. But the only difference was the intercepts with the P factor. I called it like the factor accounting for the polarity of the pesticides. And it's like based on that, I could derive some new predictive method, which of course works really well based on my samples, but I really want like to test this method on the samples we collected here like over the last 2 weeks. Another really important process like happening in the air is the particle size distribution. Basically, we have like two different types, or like we classify the particles in different like types according to their size. So either they're called like as coarse particles, which are relatively large particles, or like fine particles. Indeed, they will behave like really differently regarding human health. For example, while coarse particles will stay stuck in the upper region of the human respiratory system, fine particles, they will reach like much deeper region of the human respiratory tract, so they will be much more dangerous for human health. On the other hand, for deposition as well, it's also they behave differently. While large particles, they will deposit really close to their source, fine particles, they will remain suspended in the air for much longer periods. And so regarding, I would say, most of the organic compounds investigated, we found like that most of them were mainly present on fine particles, which means higher risk for inhalation and higher risk for the environment because they will stay longer time in the air. For example, for PAHs was like 71% of them, 73% of dioxin and furans, and 60% of dioxin like PCBs, which were present on particles smaller than 1 micrometer. Same was observed for PBDs with 55%, then 77-74% of HBCDs, which is a subclass of novel flame retardants, more than 40% for like novel flame retardants. But I would say for me, the most interesting results was for pesticides, because in one hand, we found that, okay, most pesticides, chlorpyrifos, fenpropimorph, also like all of the old pesticides, as other organic compounds, they are also like for 35-91% present on fine particles. But what was really surprising is that we observed that four pesticides, isoproteron, prochloraz, carbendazim, and carbutilazin, were from 45-70% associated with large particles. And here it's like once more, it's really unclear what caused the difference. My hypothesis is that it's the pesticide application technique, which may clearly influence like the atmospheric fate of pesticides. And this, I would like really to keep going this research in that direction, because if we can identify that using some specific spray or like maybe like this pesticide, we know they are like encapsulated within the seeds. So if, for example, this could significantly reduce the risk for human health, but also the risk for environment, we should really like promote these specific types. But once more, this is only hypothesis, and we really need like more scientific knowledge to validate that. And I just really want to highlight that it's extremely important to know the particle size distribution for two different things regarding inhalation and deposition. Because, for example, I calculated the cancer risk for these toxic chemicals, taking into account like the particle size distribution. Basically, we are well below the carcinogenic benchmark level like for Czech Republic, like in Brno. But what was interesting is that I calculated this cancer risk based on two different methods. Firstly, I really took into account like the particle size distribution. And secondly, I didn't consider that, and I just assumed only like the total concentration in the particulate phase. And here we have the ratio of the risk using total concentration versus when we use like size-specific concentrations. And what we could observe is that when we do not take into account the particle size distribution into the cancer risk from inhalation, we may clearly overestimate the cancer risk. So it's extremely important to take this into account. Similarly, regarding the deposition fluxes, we've done exactly the same method. We estimated the dry deposition or the wet deposition, taking into account the size-specific concentration or just the total concentrations. And once more, it's really evident that for all flame retardants investigated, when you do not take into account the particle size distribution, you may clearly overestimate the deposition flux, which means you may clearly underestimate the potential for long-range atmospheric transport of chemicals. So this is really important to take into account. One other like important atmospheric processes occurring, it's like the degradation. For example, here, like some Spanish colleagues, like in Valencia, made some really interesting study based. Basically, they have some kind of huge incubator, and there it's like they spiked like chlorpyrifos, and they really looked at what were the degradation compounds, and how long it will take to react with OH radicals with like environmentally relevant OH concentrations. And there they estimated that the atmospheric half-life in the air of chlorpyrifos is only 2 hours, which therefore these compounds do not fail in the conditions to be considered as persistent organic pollutants. And this is consistent, like Donald MacKay, which can be considered as a Pope's father, actually he wrote some really interesting review only based on chlorpyrifos to really assess whether this compound can be seen as a persistent organic pollutant or not. And once more, you say that regarding like its behavior in the air, it's not persistent enough, so we cannot consider it as persistent organic pollutants. And finally, like the last process I want to speak about is the air-soil exchange. And here we took some samples in Hungary, and we look at how much compounds were either volatilizing from the soil or like depositing like from the air to the soil. And we could see like really significant like day, night or diurnal variations with most of the compounds investigating, including like all pesticides. They are clearly volatilizing from the soils in the day, but depositing or either depositing either within the equilibrium in the night. And then it's also, I really like this equation. It's a bit scary, I would say, but it's really summarizing like all of what I said. And it's like I made some huge like modeling studies over 50 years in India for DDT. And basically we can see that here it's like the air concentrations and they are influenced by primary emissions, by air-soil exchange, but also by degradation processes, by dry deposition, by wet deposition. And it's like the same goes like for soil concentrations. And basically based, all of this is models, which means it's not accurate. It just gives some idea of what can happen. And here we can see like the air concentration model, and we can clearly see some huge decrease once DDT was banned in India. And therefore this also, it characterized it in terms of air-soil exchange. While when it was used, it was mainly like we are observing like deposition, but after this compound has been banned, we are mainly oscillating between revolatilization or deposition. And basically it's really important like for every compound to know like how they behave in the environment over like long time periods. And in case of persistent organic pollutants, the news are not so positive, it depends for which one, but it's like we observe that for some of them, over a like couple of years period, we can see some significant decrease with half-lives of 5-3 years. This is not only specific to OH reactions, but it's really representing like the half-life in the environment, taking into account all of the processes. But unfortunately, for some compounds as dioxininfluorines, like BD47, BD183, we cannot, even like 10 years after their inclusion into the Stockholm Convention, their levels in the environment are still constant, and we don't observe like significant decrease. So it's for these reasons, for me, I'm really interested about new pesticides, because they are currently used. And it's like, if we don't want to see them again, you know, in 20 years from now, persisting in the environment, we really need to increase the knowledge about them and to make sure that at least as scientists, we provide enough proof or like information to evaluate whether like we should or they should still be used right now or we should ban them. And now I just want to conclude like this presentation with like the future perspective or like the cooperation I'm seeing right now with University of Cape Town and Swiss TPH and Recetops. Because it's like from July 2017 to June this year, we deployed like passive air samplers at 3 different sites, so in Hex River, Pickenburg, and Cabo. And so we used like mainly like passive samplers, this one, but also for one season we deployed like XAD passive sampling. And based on that, one maybe like sad results is that I found like extremely high concentration of DDE. This is a degradation product from DDT, so it clearly suggests that DDT is not anymore used in South Africa. But still, it's so persistent, it's so much present in the soil, that it's reaching against the air and at really elevated like concentrations. And now we can also see from this figure really like spatial differences. And we know that DDT was quite used much more in Grabo, which is like apple areas, compared like to cereals or like to grape whites. On the other hand, for new pesticides, as for chlorpyrifos, for example, I still need like to work more on the results. But basically, we found that at least in July, August, we found much higher concentration in Drabo. But what was really surprising for us is that we had two sites, one at so-called like school site, more in city center, and one like farm site. And actually, we found much higher concentration of chlorpyrifos at the school site compared to the farm site. So now, I still don't know right now. I still need to work on this data to understand why it exists. And it's like then, it's really interesting to work with this data because they really reflect the different agricultural usage of the field. Because, for example, simazine, which is mainly used for cereals, shows much higher concentration in pecan belt compared like, to the other areas. But once more, was higher at the school compared to the farm site. So this we still need to understand more. And then it's like what we have been doing, like for the last 14 days, like with five other like different people from UCT, from Czech Republic. It's like we've done like really some in-depth study, trying to characterize the pesticide exposure of children in two monoculture farming areas. For this, what we've done is that at day one. We collected like quite a lot of information using questionnaires from some children, from their guardians. We also collected some soil sample. We also collected some dust, either like really by vacuuming the indoor, or also like leaving some EDC towels, which provide information about the deposition. Then we repeat exactly like the same at day seven. Like this, we could really see the differences observed between beginning and after, when we know that pesticides were used during the 7 days. Meanwhile, like the children were wearing some silicone wristbands, like this one, some GPS, and also we collected like the farm spraying records. So this, like the GPS, is really great information because it can really help us to know like how much children spend time like indoor, in their houses, but also at school, but also how much they will travel really close to the fields. And this, we can really like derive interesting information from this. But then also it's like every day we collected like air sample and also urine samples. And it's like, I really like this project because it's like, let's say, some mix between myself, which I'm more like interested about the environment, and Samuel from Swiss TPH, who was working here as well, who is much more interesting about urban exposure, urban. And I will say now from this study, we really expect like to obtain like really interesting and important information about the daily atmospheric levels of pesticides, the gas particle partitioning, the aerosol exchange, but then also we'll understand the levels in settled dust, in EDC towers, in silicone wristbands, and all of this we will try like to connect it with different like exposure routes. So firstly like through inhalation of the children, but then also through the ingestion either of soil particles or like dust particles. And finally using like the excretion of pesticides from the urine, then we can finally like try to have some global overview of like how much pesticide or like how much children are exposed to pesticides. And by this, definitely I want to thank like all of the funding agencies. Special thanks to my supervisor, like Professor Yana Klonova and Professor Gerard Flamel and Dr. Lisa Melimouk. Definitely this work was also like part from many other colleagues from Resetox and Max Planck Institute who contributed to this work. Definitely, like, thanks a lot for the great fieldwork team we had like over the last 2 weeks here in South Africa. And here you can just see like some photography of the soil samples. Here we have the air sample, which was used like the last 2 weeks. Then we have like the children, and it's like also like the fieldwork team, like from the two different like fields where we were. We can see the urine sample, the soil sample, and the EDC towel. And if you have any questions, I would be glad to take them.
Thank you. Very interesting presentation. Any questions?
Yeah.
Very interesting. Thank you. We did a study of a school on a farm in Liverpool, and we came to UCT, came here to test the surfaces as a control. We found these carpets full of chlorpyrifos. I would have suggested that the result for the school might be due to pest spray in the school. But then you said the slide about cinnazine. I can't understand why cinnazine should be higher in the school. But, so there might be something about the enclosed space jumping out of there.
Nice, like definitely one thing when we were discussing like with different farmers like last week, it seemed that definitely the household pesticide usage is extremely important against mosquitoes, but also against ticks, for example, for dogs. So this may be one reason, but what I'm more interested in that both sides, they were like just a couple of 100 meters from each other, and it's really important the wind direction, the wind speed, and maybe like if, for example, the school, most of the wind from the fields is going to the school but not to the farm site, then this may explain the results. But still to look at it.
Yeah. So you don't have fracking in Europe?
No, I don't.
So in South Africa, there's a lot of licenses in process for fracking, and I understand what are the consequences of fracking in the US. The Utah Basin is very high levels of volatile compounds on a population level.
Mm-hmm.
So that might be something to study in future if fracking gets approved here, because depending on the wind, climate conditions, it would be generating pollutants in a relatively unpopulated area, so nobody will notice it.
Yeah. And do you know if fracking is done in specific season or it's like all year round? Okay, but this definitely, like for all pesticides which are stored in the soils, clearly will revitalize everything.
Comment following yours. They are fracking now in Lancashire, in the north of England.
Okay.
And there are reports of associated low-grade earth tremors.
Low what, sorry?
Low-grade earth tremors.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's not... Maybe mainland Europe is not fracking, but in England, yes.
Sorry, I didn't know about that. Mm. I know in France and Czech Republic, it's not, and I don't know about that.
Yeah, I just want to make regarding DDT that you detected in the Western Cape. Basically, DDT is not used in the Western Cape, but it is used in South Africa. So I don't know to what extent that could have. But I'm quite interested to see that DDT, some of the peaks were actually higher than some of the contemporaries. So that's quite one thought it would be lower, but it's actually higher than cinnazine, and even chloroprifos is higher than in one part of the year, but then it goes lower. Mm-hmm. But DDT is actually high through. So there's actually a possibility that people are actually exposed to DDT. So.
Definitely, I would say. It's like as you mentioned, I forgot to precise it, but DDT is like banned in most countries in Europe, definitely, but it's still authorized like as a vector, disease vector control against malaria. So, but this is really big ethical questions, because we know that DDT is really great against mosquitoes, but in the same time, it will contaminate all of the population, and like, what shall we do? Oh, it's a big issue. But definitely, the concentration of DDT are relatively high.
So is that something one should actually control for then, if you're looking at the epidemiological study, investigate the health effect of contemporary pesticides?
Mm-hmm.
So would DDT then be a confounder?
Definitely. And I would say, compared to like new pesticides, there are like really lots of knowledge about the neurodevelopmental behavior, like damage from DDT, like into like different children. So this should definitely like be considered.
Any other questions?
And maybe just I would like to highlight some points. I brought some special specialties from Czech Republic and also some blueberries from the field campaign. So please like help yourself. It's just everything is on the background and enjoy it.
If you'd like to give me a card, I can email you the information when I get the information.
Definitely, unfortunately, I don't have.